Good evening. I guess we'll get started. I hope you can hear me clearly. My name is Jerry Carbone. I'm the library director, and I welcome you to the library for our penultimate First Wednesday lecture this season. The last lecture, in fact, will be on May 5th with the return of Vermont writer Howard Frank Mosier, who will read from his newest work, Walking to Gatlinburg, a great American novel of love and war. And there are flyers on your seats in case you want to take one to get reminded. We are grateful for our sponsor, the Vermont Humanities Council, which has spread the First Wednesday lecture series to 9 libraries all around the state. These lectures are freely accessible, but are not free. The local hosting library must come up with $2,800 for the 8 lectures. So I ask you to support our local Friends of Brooks Memorial Library, who raise funds to support these lectures. And I'll mention some of the organizations that raise funds from. There's the Friends, who contribute, Brattleboro Savings and Loan, Entergy Vermont, and the statewide sponsors, the Vermont Department of Libraries. And for this lecture tonight, I want to especially thank the Wyndham World Affairs Council of Vermont. The WWAC has unwritten Mr. Schmidle's talk, and I want to thank board members, especially Javed Chaudhry, for picking Nick up at Bradley Airport today and entertaining him on the way up here. And Margo Neal, the president of WWAC, please a round of applause for them. Thank you. It's now my pleasure to introduce Nicholas Schmidle. As I said, Nick just arrived in Brattleboro about 7 hours ago, and the first thing he did was to check into the Latches Hotel and go for a jog. So I wanted to find out how he liked the hills of Brattleboro.
Good. It's awesome.
Nicholas writes for the New York Times Magazine, Slate, the New Republic, Smithsonian, the Virginia Quarterly Review, among other publications. A fellow at the New America Foundation received the 2008 Kurt Schork Award for Freelance Journalism. Nick's book, To Live or Perish Forever, Two Tumultuous Years in Pakistan, was just issued in a paperback last month. You know that Nick must have had a great sense of humor, especially after his stay in Pakistan, because the titles of his magazine pieces kept getting funnier to me. So here I'll pass a few along to you. There's the piece entitled Pack It In. There's the Talibanistan piece. Pakistan's Next Fight, Don't Go There. The Dictator Takes Up His Golf Clubs. Pakistan Kicked Me Out, Others Were Less Lucky. And then finally, My Buddy, the Jihadi. I hope tonight Nick will tell us about how he came to these titles. Please welcome Nicholas Schmidle.
I'm not going to do jumping jacks or anything. I just need to clear stuff out of my pockets. Well, thank you all so much for coming out this evening. When you're fighting against, you know, perfect weather, it's always impressive that anyone has done anything other than sitting outside at a park drinking wine or something, which is what I would probably be doing. But nonetheless, it's great to see you all here. I will get into talk a little bit about the titles of some of the pieces, but generally speaking, titles are usually devised by the editors and not by the writers. But some of them I had a hand in, some of them actually that I didn't have a hand in ultimately got me in trouble. So I'll get to all that over the course of the next half an hour or so. I'd like to talk about, first I'll talk about how I got to Pakistan, what I was doing there, and then how I got kicked out twice. And what I've been doing since. And then we can turn it over to question and answer, and I'm sure there'll be plenty of questions. So I really had no journalism experience in 2005 when I applied, or actually it was in early 2004, when I decided that I was ready to try and become a journalist, that I wanted to become an international journalist, but frankly, the opportunities in the current media landscape, as we all know, are shrinking. The opportunities for someone to come in as a beat reporter for the New York Times, go from the Metro desk to the business desk to the foreign correspondent, to eventually become, you know, the bureau chief of Pakistan, those opportunities are pretty much slim to none. And so the only ways nowadays, it seemed to me, that these opportunities would be available is if you simply found a place that seemed newsworthy and you went there on your own dime and you sort of hoped for good, you hoped for bad news for them, good news for you. Which would be that editors were interested in whatever place you were in, and you were able to try and leverage the fact that you were already there. So, I I actually graduated with my undergraduate degree was in philosophy and religion, and I moved to Loyola, Chicago, and started a PhD program in philosophy in 2003. And about a semester into this PhD program, I realized that becoming the world's foremost expert on Jürgen Habermas was not going to pay the bills like I thought it once would. And so I changed graduate programs, went back to Washington, D.C., where my parents were living, and enrolled in a program at American University in international relations. I figured that there, you know, you don't get a lot of money, you don't make a lot of money working for the State Department or working with the government, but at least there are jobs there in D.C. Well, midway through the first semester that I was there, I had this fantastic teacher who had great relations with the reform movement in Iran. And she was teaching a class on modern Iran, and she said, you know, if any of you all are interested in spending the summer in Tehran, I can probably help make it happen. So, to make a long story short, come July, I had enrolled at Tehran University, and I was learning Persian and living in the dormitories in Tehran. And this was just an amazing, amazing opportunity. And again, it gets back to the thing that I mentioned earlier, is that, you know, it didn't cost much. I got there, I was able to write a few stories while I was there, and I came back, and you know, now, frankly, I didn't know that much about Iran, but I just spent 2 months there, and frankly, there weren't really any other people in D.C. or in the States that could say that they had just spent 2 months in Iran. So I had this a little bit of an advantage of having boots on the ground and muddy boots and whatnot. So I found out about this opportunity from this organization called the Institute of Current World Affairs, which had been based in Hanover, New Hampshire, since the 1920s, and just recently moved to D.C. They were looking to send someone to Iran for 2 years on a 2-year writing fellowship. So I thought, all right, well, you know, this sounds like a pretty good gig. I'll apply. Didn't think I had a chance. Applied. Lo and behold, finally got the fellowship. A week later, though, is when President Ahmadinejad was elected president. And suddenly the likelihood of the Iranian government giving a 27-year-old American with a father who's a general in the Marine Corps a 2-year visa to roam the country, sort of, you know, writing about the country's ethnic and identity problems, that wasn't going to work. So I went back to the foundation and I said, look, I don't know anything about Pakistan. I don't speak Urdu, but I know that they have some of the same identity and ethnic issues that I wanted to study in Iran, and I do study, and I do speak some Persian. And eventually the fellowship relented and they said, okay, you can go to Pakistan instead. So on Valentine's Day of 2006, I left my lovely bride in Washington and left for Pakistan. She joined me a month later, and I would spend the next 2 years. The only instructions from this fellowship were that you go to whatever country of your desire for 2 years, you don't come home, you learn the local language, and you write about what you see. So as an aspiring journalist, you know, it's kind of, I mean, it doesn't really get much better than that. And so I'd made a pact with both my mother and with my wife before I left that I wasn't going to get entangled. I wasn't going to start reporting on Pakistan's jihadi movement. That was something that I was going to stay away from. That frankly, we'd seen what happened to Daniel Pearl in January of 2002 when he was kidnapped and ultimately beheaded. And that I was going to look for sort of offbeat stories and try and understand Pakistan holistically, but I wasn't going to get entangled in the Islamists and the militants. Well, if you're in Pakistan in 2006, it becomes a bit inevitable after a while. So I did stories about ethnic politics in Karachi. I did a profile of a rock and roll musician who was sort of cashing in his cultural clout and had just done this movie that was questioning the role of the mullahs in society. But increasingly, like I said, it became very clear to me that I had this advantage of being there. I was learning Urdu. I was becoming conversant in Urdu after a short time. And that, you know, this is where the story was with the rise of the Taliban, and so I needed to sort of be following that. Well, I had a friend, a Pakistani friend in Karachi, who we were talking very casually one day. I was living in Islamabad at the time, and he said to me, you know, look, just down the street from your house is the Red Mosque, and the head of the Red Mosque is this guy named Abdul Rashid Ghazi, and If the Pakistani Taliban ever come to power, Abdul Rashid Ghazi could well become the emir or the leader of the Pakistani Taliban. And he said, look, the guy speaks English and he's very, very approachable. You should go and start talking to him. So I asked him what the best way to do that was, and he said, well, he's got this inner sort of interlocutor that you should reach out to first, and then he'll put you in touch with Ghazi. Now, it turns out that the go-between guy is, in fact, the last person, one of the last people that Daniel Pearl ever spoke to before he disappeared. But this guy, this guy was Ghazi's media man in the beginning. And so he said, okay, let's meet at this upscale cafe in Islamabad, and you can tell me why you want to meet Ghazi. So this chap and I, long beard, former ISI official from the intelligence agencies, self-proclaimed close friend of Osama bin Laden, but again, spoke English. And the language is a fascinating thing. When you're in a country where people don't speak your language, or where you can converse in Urdu, but you can't sort of get to nuance. And when someone understands idiomatic, nuanced English, and they can speak it back to you, even if you shouldn't trust them, you automatically do a little bit more. So this individual and I were sitting there, and he said to me, so tell me why you want to meet Ghazi, and I told him I wanted to better understand the group's ideas, etc. And he said, okay, listen, I'm going to go talk to Ghazi, and I'm going to ask him if he'll agree to meet with you. And if he does, then we'll go from there. But if I tell you that Ghazi's off limits, I don't want to hear that you're going behind my back trying to meet him through other channels. Because that's what I told Daniel Pearl about Sheikh Gilani, and he kind of put his hands up and said, and you see what happened to Daniel Pearl. And I tell you what, I've never felt, I would never feel that uncomfortable for a very long time while I was in Pakistan. But ultimately, a week later, he called and he said, listen, Ghazi's ready to meet you. So this begins my relationship with this Abdul Rashid Ghazi character. Now, Ghazi was a fascinating, fascinating case study, because it became very apparent that it is easy to go to foreign places and to write about foreign people and foreign places and make them sound very exotic and make them sound very otherworldly. It's much more difficult, particularly when you're dealing with Islamist militants, to make them, to empathize with them enough that readers, like you all, feel some connection to them. It's very easy for you to say, oh my God, this person's a wacko. So that became my challenge with Ghazi once I met him, was to empathize with him enough that readers felt some connection. Well, it became kind of easy, because Ghazi was an incredibly charismatic guy. He had a master's degree in international relations from an English university in Islamabad. He spoke perfect idiomatic English. In 1998, he was both working for UNICEF, United Nations Children's Fund, and along with his father, visited Osama bin Laden in Kandahar. So this is a guy who's got a foot in both worlds, and is very, knows how to work the press, and yet has an incredible stake and incredible amount of influence within the burgeoning Taliban movement. So when I go to meet Ghazi the first day, I go to the Red Mosque. Ghazi is holed up in a room back through a network of alleys, because he's been on sort of quasi-house arrest for the previous year and a half, and hasn't officially left the mosque. And so I'm led back through. At the entrance to Ghazi's room, there are two teenage madrasa students who just at that exact moment happen to be sharpening a sword. And I thought, all right, this has got to be some sort of cruel joke. And so I come up and I said, you know, listen, they, at the front desk, they told me to come down this alley. I come down this alley and I've got you two sharpening a sword. Ghazi's supposed to be waiting for me. And Ghazi overhears me and he comes out of the room and he looks at these two and he starts chuckling and he says, hey, everybody calm down. Come with me. Now, Ghazi looks like Jerry Garcia. That's the first thing I think when I see him. He's got a big gray bushy beard, curly hair that flips out under a maroon knit cap, a really easy smile, really easy laugh, wireframe glasses. And he says, after he dismisses these two madrasa students and kind of laughs, he knows what was going through my head. He says, you know, calm down. You've come as a guest, and you're a guest of mine now, and nothing's going to happen to you. We're sitting in this room, just he and I, and there's an AK-47 on one side. There is a pistol laying on the couch, on the bed over here, and then there's another weapon leaning against the computer. And there's a bank of computers and a fax machine and everything else. And he says, you know, you're my guest now. If someone were to come into this room and say, where's Nicholas? I'm here to take him. Ghazi said, those weapons will go against them, not against you. And this is a huge, huge theme to understand both what it's like as an American reporter working in Pakistan and what it's like as foreign militants that are holed up in the tribal areas right now. Hospitality, and what it's like as a Pakistani traveling to another town or another area. I mean, hospitality is the dominant feature of public and social life. So my relationship with Ghazi develops. He becomes something of a fixer for me. We meet probably once every month or two. We sit for 2 hours, 3 hours. He just regales me with stories about his relationships with various Al-Qaeda luminaries, and is very open. And I can never quite, everyone always asks why he wanted to talk to me. And it was something I also just sort of took for granted, never quite understood. I was very upfront. I mean, I said, listen, I'm working on a book. You're not going to see the fruits of my labors, of our conversations, for a very long time. Ultimately, he would never see the fruits of those labors. But I said, you're not going to see them for a very long time. You know, if he wanted to do a Google search, he could see that my father was in the Marines. But he was very open with me. And I was very open in saying, look, I'm here to learn. I want to learn about Islam. I want to learn about Pakistan. I want to learn about what you all are thinking. And so I think that they also saw me as something like the ultimate. I mean, there is this notion within Islam that you know, you spread the word of Islam. And they always thought that I was sort of on the verge of converting. And I said, look, you know, if you want to, I'm a student of Islam. I'm not necessarily a religious man. But if you want to think that, and that keeps our relationship warm, then we'll keep that going. So Ghazi, though, before I would travel, both in Islamabad, going to religious festivals, or before I would even travel to other cities in Pakistan, or even other cities outside of Pakistan, in Bangladesh, for instance, I would call Ghazi, and I would stop by the mosque using a special SIM card that I had in my phone, driving my own car there, and of course always looking underneath as I was getting to make sure that no one had planted any bombs before I left. And that's an indication, too, of the paranoia. That, I mean, the first 3-4 visits, I didn't think about it. By the 6th and 7th visit, I'd always just kind of take a quick look underneath. But Ghazi would take his business card, which was written in Urdu on one side, and on the back he'd write the name of someone in Karachi or in Dhaka, Bangladesh, or in Islamabad or in Lahore, and Ghazi would then write his name on the back, the phone number, and sign it. And I would show up in a town. I showed up in Dhaka, Bangladesh, with this card from Ghazi to meet this character named Mufti Shahidul Islam, this politician, quasi-militant in Dhaka. And when I showed up, I went to the Bangladeshi journalist and I said, you know, have you all ever heard of this person? He said, yeah, that person, you know, he's super extreme, he'll never meet with you, blah, blah, blah. And I said, well, I've got this reference, I want to see what happens. I call this guy up, I tell him who sent me. Sure enough, 2 days later, I'm welcomed into his madrasa as a brother. Because, you know, having this reference from Ghazi is like having a golden ticket sort of thing. In January of 2007, while I was in Bangladesh, Ghazi and his boys began their Talibanization campaign in earnest. Actually, it was Ghazi and his girls. There was a female madrasa that was attached to the Red Mosque, and the girls overtook a children's library that was also adjacent to the mosque. And this sort of signaled the beginning of their campaign, as they said, to remove vice and promote virtue in the city. Now, Islamabad is a very, very, very dull town. This is not a town that these sorts of things are always happening. It used to be a joke that Islamabad is kind of like Arlington National Cemetery, only half as big and twice as dead. It's a very quiet place. So when this all started happening, and Ghazi's boys were going and raiding brothels and grabbing brothel owners and kidnapping policemen, and the policemen came back to try and rescue the brothel owners, it was a real shock to the system. An AP reporter went to Ghazi around this time and said to him, "So does this signal the Talibanization of New York, the Talibanization of Islamabad?" And Ghazi's response was, "Look, when Rudy Giuliani became the mayor of New York, he went after the brothels too. Did anybody call that the Talibanization of New York City?" And whether it was an apt analogy or not, you had to think, "All right, touche for the cultural reference." So this is, again, this is a glimpse into who Ghazi was. In late June, early July, he went one step too far. He'd been antagonizing the government. They'd been manning intersections and stopping cars and you know, apparently telling women that they couldn't drive, even though this was something that they often debated. They were very, very open in supporting the Taliban, supporting Al-Qaeda in their Friday prayer speeches. They had draped the outside of the mosque with large posters that you know, extolled jihad and whatnot. And then they went too far and they kidnapped 6 Chinese masseuses from a massage parlor across town. And the Chinese and the Pakistanis the governments have a very close relationship. The Chinese have invested a great amount of money in Pakistan in recent years. And the supposition was that the Chinese government got on the phone to President Musharraf. And at this point, actually, the Karakoram Highway, which connects Pakistan to China over the Himalayas, and which the Chinese had built. At this point, there had been a roadblock that had been like 2 weeks that the rocks hadn't been moved, and the Chinese were already kind of like, look, you know, we built the road, so just get a helicopter or a bulldozer and get the rocks out of the way so we can, you know, so the trade can continue. So within a day or two after the masseuses were kidnapped, military began forming a circle around the mosque and slowly tightening the circle. No one knows exactly who fired the first shot, but eventually shots started going off, and this began the siege of the Red Mosque. And commandos on the 10th day of the siege stormed the mosque, killed Abdul Rashid Ghazi in the basement, and then the government proceeded, you know, and Ghazi had become sort of public enemy number one by this point, and proceeded to then parade Ghazi's dead body in front of the TVs to say, you know, we got him. And so here I am, sitting in my room. My wife had since left Pakistan for a little bit to take a break. And I'm watching the TVs, and it was a really complicated time because, you know, here's a guy who, like I said, was responsible for the deaths of dozens, if not hundreds, in this standoff. Here's a guy who just led a sort of a mini rebellion in the middle of Islamabad. And yet here's someone who had been so central to my experience in Pakistan so far and so central to my access. So this is when I sat down and I wrote this piece for Slate, which is maybe you know, sort of an alternative online magazine. You know, decent readership, but not huge. And so I wrote the piece, and it detailed my relationship with Ghazi and his final hours. And it was titled Farewell, My Jihadi Friend. And I thought, okay, that was, you know, that's enough of a tongue-in-cheeky-ish sort of title. The Washington Post, however, owns Slate. And 2 days later, the Washington Post called me in Pakistan, and they said, we love the story, we're going to run it in the Sunday paper. And I thought, you know, normally I would be jumping for joy, but I thought, yeah, it's kind of a controversial story. And my wife was, in fact, my parents were living in Okinawa at the time, and my wife was staying with them in Okinawa. And that Sunday morning, she called me, and she said, both your parents, they both have their laptops open, they're both staring at the screen with this absolutely dumbfounded look on their faces. The piece had been titled My Buddy the Jihadi. So my dad, the two-star general, the head of the air base, and she said, you know, your parents, they don't seem to be taking it real well. my brother, mind you, was a first lieutenant in the Marines and was actually in Iraq at the time fighting against jihadis in Al-Anbar province. So it was, you know, it was certainly a unique time for me to have written this piece. Now, one of the things that became apparent, though, over the course of the lead up to the Red Mosque and to the final days, was not so much the military rebellion that had culminated those last 10 days, but more the cultural rebellion that Ghazi and his boys had launched. And what that meant was that all of the traditional authority structures that had fostered the Taliban in the 1990s, those being the intelligence agencies, those being the tribes themselves up and down the border of Afghanistan, and those being the Islamist religious parties that had given the militants some legitimate political cover. All of these entities had tried to intervene, to go to Ghazi, to go to the Red Mosque and say, look, you know, you've gone too far, and all of them had no success. And Ghazi would time and time again say, look, the youth are with me. The youth are angry. They're ready to fight. There's no time left. There's no room left for dialogue anymore. And so that really marked something pretty significant in the evolution of the militant movement, in my mind. And that kind of formed what something significant enough that I then went to the New York Times Magazine. They didn't know me from Adam, and I said, look, you know, this is what I've just done. I feel like I've got a great visa. I had this 2-year visa to go anywhere in the country. I said, I can get into areas that other reporters can't. And there's a story here about this emerging new generation of Taliban that are no longer beholden to the authority that we think could potentially moderate them. So, but unfortunately, I no longer had Ghazi to make the introductions into this group. What I did have, though, was the translation in Urdu that ran in several newspapers of my piece, My Buddy the Jihadi, which painted an empathetic side, gave sort of my empathetic impression of him. So with this piece now as my entree, and you know, I'd go to people and say, I knew Ghazi, this is the evidence of it, etc. It allowed me to, over the course of the fall of 2007, report extensively up and down the border areas, right outside of South Waziristan. And eventually, in October of 2007, I was able to get into the Swat Valley for 3 days, just at the time that the Taliban had begun taking over. Now, the other lesson that people often don't realize about international reporting is how important fixers, local translators, local journalists are to everything that you see. Any good foreign story that you see is usually like 40% the work of the person who's got their byline on it, and 60% the work of the local journalist who has the contacts, who knows the phone numbers of so-and-so, who's able to get the interviews and get the access. So in this case, a friend of a friend was in Mingora, Swat, and said he was willing to help me for 3 days and had good contacts within Maulana Fazlullah's faction of the Taliban. Maulana Fazlullah was the head of the Pakistani Taliban in Swat. And said to me, you know, come for 3 days and we'll see what we can do. So I took a public bus there's a public bus system there that's run by the Daewoo company that is incredibly efficient, on time, air conditioned. I mean, it's really, people think that getting around Pakistan on buses is a hard thing. It's actually really, really easy. But, you know, speaking Urdu helps because you get into bus stations and you're accosted by T-boys and whatnot. But it nonetheless is pretty simple to get around. So I took this public bus into Mingora. And this fixer was waiting for me. He says, okay, let's go drop your bags right now because we have a meeting with Iqbal Khan. Now, Iqbal Khan was the head of a pro-Taliban faction in Swat that was not sort of the most extreme, but nonetheless had still, they were called TNSM, or Tariq-e-Nafaz Shariat Muhammadiyya, the Movement for the Implementation of Sharia Law. And so we arranged to meet the Swat head of this group. Now, we left the hotel. We got into my fixer's car, and we started driving. And the drive from Mingora out of the town hugs the Swat River. And it's an absolutely gorgeous, gorgeous drive. I mean, the cliffs rise up on one side of the road, the river's on the other, the mountains rise sort of on the other side of the river. I mean, it's just, Swat has been a tourist destination for decades. Mr. Chowdhury and I were talking about this on the way. I mean, he used to visit every other month when he was a child. You know, my wife and I had gone there and were playing badminton in Swat just 4 months before I went there to report on the Taliban. So this is really a sad story about an area's fall from grace. But as we're winding along this river, my fixer gets a call, and it's another local journalist, and he says, where are you guys? And he quickly tells him, and he says, well, because the word is that the Taliban have erected a series of roadblocks all around the city, and they're looking for spies, they're looking for people with CD players and tape decks playing un-Islamic music, and they're looking for women that are improperly covered. So, thinking that I was going to pull a fast one on someone, I had dressed up all in local garb, I had a light beard, I had dyed my hair, and I had a scarf over my shoulder, and I thought, you know, all of a sudden you sort of take a quick look at yourself like a kid on Halloween who's getting yelled at, and you can become very self-conscious that this is not going to fool anybody. And we come around the next bend, and there are 5 flatbed trucks with about 60 militants in the back of each truck, and there are rocket launchers and AK-47s pointing every which way. And we quickly call Iqbal Khan, who we were going to pick up, and we were going to go to his house and break the fast for Ramadan. And Iqbal Khan says, okay, quick, give me your license plate number and quick description of your car. We do that, hang up. He says, don't worry about it. We hang up, and we come around the bend, and there they all are. We start inching forward, and there are all these cars in front of us, all lined up behind us. And almost everyone is getting pulled to the side, and they're having their trunk checked, and they're, you know, the passengers have stepped out, and the Taliban are looking under the seats for booze and whatnot. And we're inching forward, and inching forward, and inching forward. And all of a sudden, we're in the next car, and there's all these guys with long hair and floppy caps. And it's one of those moments that if I was a real journalist and not someone who was scared out of his mind, I would have taken out my camera. But it's one of those things where you thought, you know, if I take out my camera now, it could get really, really bad. So I'm just going to try and hold this picture in my mind as long as I can. And so we pull forward, and the Taliban take a look at our car, they take a look at our license plate, and they part, and we drive through. And I thought, I don't know who Iqbal Khan is, but obviously he's got some connections. So, and so about 200 yards up around the next bend, Iqbal Khan's waiting for us. standing there on the side of the road, and we throw open the door, and he gets in, and he looks at my fixer and I, who are both now sweating, and my heart is, you know, beating out of my neck, and he's just dying laughing. He says, listen, I told you, you're our guest for the weekend, you're guest of the Taliban, you're fine, don't worry about it, we'll take care of you. You're not really sure what you do with that, sort of. Is that consolation, or is that... So we go to Iqbal Khan's house this evening, on this particular evening, and we break the fast, and, you know, it's a huge feast, and we're drinking tea, and Iqbal Khan then seems to, he senses that I'm empathetic, but he sort of mistakes and confuses sympathy for empathy. And this is something that I, in fact, oftentimes ran up against, is wondering, you know, there's a very definitive line there, and, you know, remembering sort of that... Let me just tell the story, and we'll see in a second. So Iqbal Khan takes out his camera, and he starts showing me videos that he's uploaded of IED attacks against American soldiers in Afghanistan and Iraq. Again, my 24-year-old brother at the time is serving in Iraq, avoiding IEDs. I thought, you know, this is a little bit uncomfortable. And at this moment is I probably the most grateful I am that I've ever studied philosophy, because we get into talking about Islamic philosophy, and it seems like an avenue to change the subject. And Iqbal Khan says to me, so he puts away the camera and he says, you know, I'm like, anything just to stop watching, you know, American tanks getting blown up, it's a little bit intense for me. And Iqbal Khan says, well, you know that Sheikh Osama, as he calls him, you know that Sheikh Osama has written a philosophy book. And I said, no, I didn't know that. He says, well, come in the room next door and I'll show you the book. And so we're in this log cabin in the middle of the SWAT, in the middle of this pine forest in the SWAT Valley, about 2 hours from the nearest city, Mingora, which is in itself about 4 hours from Islamabad, from home. And there's a bookshelf that Iqbal Khan keeps all of his Al-Qaeda and Taliban paraphernalia on. And he has 9mm Berettas that he claims he's recovered from American soldiers in Afghanistan. He has signed letters from Mullah Omar thanking him for delivering goods in the late 90s. All sorts of DVDs and jihadi books. And then at the bottom there's a knapsack. And he says, actually the book that I want to show you is in that knapsack. And I promised the person who left that bag that I would never touch, that I wouldn't touch it until he returned. And I thought, okay, so, you know, Iqbal, you've got the guns, you've obviously got influence within the Taliban, you know, who left this bag here, so worried about it? He said, well, this bag was left by Ayman al-Zawahiri, Al-Qaeda's number two. And I thought, all right, so, you know, uncomfortable moment of the night, like number 10 at this point. And so we went into the next room and made eye contact with my fixer, and I said, listen, you know, we should really get going. I'm getting a little spooked as to what Iqbal Khan is what's going on here. It would seem to me that Ayman al-Zawahiri was in this house or was in very close contact to this house at some point in the past. So that's on Wednesday. On Friday morning, we have an appointment to go meet Maulana Fazlullah, who was the military chief of the Pakistani Taliban in SWAT. And Fazlullah has a mosque compound on the other side of the river that we had driven along two nights earlier. And so my fixer and I are in my hotel room on Friday morning, and everything's all set, but we're both kind of having second thoughts, and we're thinking, you know, what happens if we get across the river and this goes wrong or that goes wrong, etc. And so we thought, all right, listen, let's call Iqbal Khan and see if Iqbal Khan will go with us. I mean, we know the guy is a little bit out there, we know he's got serious friends in all the wrong places, but we've broken bread with him, we've drank tea with him, you know, he's probably not going to sit and watch as they, you know, take us away and try and cut our heads off or something. So let's bank on that little bit of camaraderie from two nights ago. We call Iqbal Khan, and again, remember that this is the story that I'm working on at the time is about this division within the militants, and sort of it's a race to become, you know, who's more radical than the next. And we call Iqbal Khan and we say, listen, and we tell him the story. We say, well, you know, will you go with us? And his response is an immediate and an emphatic one. He says, no way, those guys are extremists. So this is the division again, if you will. So that Friday, though, my fixer and I eventually decided that we were going to go. So we get in his car. There are two ways to get to the compound from Mingora, the main city. You can either drive around the river and go through a series of small villages that are all under Taliban control, but does run the risk that someone at one of the checkpoints isn't going to have gotten the notice that there's an American journalist coming through. Or we could drive along the side of the road, park the car, and then the Taliban had actually set up a zip line from the road across the Swat River into the directly that just landed people right in the middle of their compound, And so that actually was seemed like the safer option. So we jump into the zip line. It's like a six-person carriage, and there are four other guys that get in with us, with Iqbal and I. We're all going to the Friday. We're all going for the Friday prayer, and we push off the side, and you know, go careening over the Swat River. It was you know, the best Disney World ride you've ever taken. But you know, our car and any chance of us making a quick getaway also disappear on the other side of the river, and you realize that okay, again, we've trusted totally in these guys that this whole hospitality thing is going to work out like they say it is. And on the other side, there are Milana Fosalula's boys, his senior lieutenants, and they're all waiting for us, and they say, you know, welcome, come with us, let's go meet Milana Fosalula. Now, no one at this point has met Milana Fosalula yet in public. He had a very brief encounter with someone from the Christian Science Monitor like 2 years before this encounter, but since he had taken up arms, he'd not met any foreign journalist, and other journalists he'd only talked to on the phone. So we get to Fazlula's sort of area where all of his bodyguards are hanging out, and there's a kind of an urban myth. Well, what seemed up to that point to be an urban myth, which is that the tribal areas in Swat were just absolutely swimming with Uzbek militants, and the Pakistani government often blamed the assassination of tribal elders and these sorts of activities on the Uzbeks. And I always thought, you know, like, unless I see an Uzbek, it's hard to know whether that's just the government blaming their problems on foreign nationals that are in their country. Well, we're sitting there, and in the bodyguard room, there are a bunch of Uzbeks, and I thought, oh, good Lord, here are the Uzbeks in flesh. And I'm so focused on them that I don't even notice when this short guy with long curls down to here, really bad teeth and a big black turban comes up and is standing in front of me, and this is Milana Fosalula, and my fixer, you know, he nudges me and he says, listen, he's right here. So I spin around, and Fosalula says he apologizes that he's not able to be with us the whole day. It was during the end of Ramadan, and there was a period of meditation called Etikaf, and he says, you know, sorry, I'm in Etikaf, so I'm not really even supposed to be talking to infidels, but, you know, you're our guest, and I just wanted to make sure that you knew you were welcome to walk around anywhere you want. And he says, so, you know, you feel free to walk anywhere. Now, there's a PA system that's set up that's playing jihadi poems, you know, extolling, you know, talking, you know, one of the poems was a father talking to his son and sort of saying, you know, now you're 12, now you're ready to go fight jihad, and people walk around with guns. And, I mean, it's one of those things where he thought, there are many people amongst this crowd that have waited nothing more their whole lives than to see an American and you know, to kill an American. So Fazlullah says, you can go anywhere. And I said, yeah, you know, tell him we really appreciate the offer, but it's a fairly dicey scene out there for me with my bad hair dye and bad beard to be walking around. So we, you know, my fixer tells Fazlullah, and Fazlullah then looks to his right and looks to his left and takes his right-hand man, his top bodyguard, and he says, okay, your job is to guard the American for the day. Again, the hospitality thing, just unbelievable. So now we have Milana Fazlullah's top bodyguard, and we're just wandering the premises like, you know, we own the place. And after the Friday prayers on this day, it was kind of a coming out party for the Pakistani Taliban, and for the Swat Taliban. And after the Friday prayers, 10,000, 15,000 people all migrated to a wooden platform that they had set up a few hundred yards away from the mosque. And on this particular day, they were going to administer their first public punishment, or what they call tazirat. And the punishment was only supposed to be lashings, but again, you know, I've two nights earlier, you know, I thought that maybe Amin al-Zawahiri was going to come out of the bathroom looking for his backpack, and now I'm at this platform, and I'm not, you know, you're really not sure, okay, it's supposed to be lashings, but are they going to chop this guy's hands off? What are they going to do? So apparently there had been three alleged criminals that had been roped up a few weeks earlier for their involvement in the kidnapping plot. And these criminals were going to be punished. And they were, you know, they were late teens, early 20s. And so the 15,000 people are all seated very, with great, great discipline, the best crowd control that I've seen at any Pakistan public event. And everyone's lined up. And the militants, you know, get, and you can see people starting to take their cell phones out of their pockets, getting ready to photograph what's surely going to be, you know, the scene of the year. And all of a sudden the PA system comes alive and someone says, anyone seen using their cameras to take photographs will be dealt with accordingly. I've never seen so many cameras drop into people's front pockets quite so quickly. So these three individuals are brought out, though, and they're frog marched up onto the platform, and they're laid down, and their hands are held, and their legs are held, and each of them are lashed 25, 20, and 15 times with a thick leather belt. And, you know, The lashings themselves were not that bad. I mean, no doubt about it, they were uncomfortable. They were, you know, these individuals were, you know, writhing and jumping around and crying up on the stage. But frankly, 10 years, 15 years in a Pakistani jail versus 10 lashings on one Friday and then you're done. I mean, there's obviously the shame and the public humiliation that comes with it. But it, that to me wasn't what was so powerful, as much as it was such an example that the Pakistani government's writ had collapsed. I mean, we're 4 hours from the capital, a main road connecting Mangora and Islamabad, and the government is nowhere to be seen. In fact, the government is present. The local authorities are present, but they're present as guests of the Taliban, essentially just there to sanction what the Taliban are doing, because they've got no power. This is before the operation, the military operation began, that eventually sort of scattered them and flushed them out. But at this point, the government is totally impotent. So this story, this is in October. I reported the story for a couple more months. The piece came out the first week of January, a week after Benazir Bhutto was assassinated. The piece came out on a Sunday, and on Tuesday, seven police officers showed up at the house, at my wife and I were living in. And it was a cold Tuesday, rainy Tuesday night, and they handed me a deportation order that said Nicholas Schmidle and Ricky Schmidle, my wife, both of their visas have been canceled effective immediately. Upon delivery of this notice, they have 45 minutes to an hour to get to the airport. So, again, you're sort of at this point wondering, all right, so who is the most important person that I have on my cell phone that I can call and try and do something about this? Because this is, you know, there's no way I can pack in an hour. There's no way I can get out of the country in an hour. So my wife, even though it took her a bit of time to adjust to Pakistan, it's very, you know, it's not easy for foreign women to find their stride. My wife, though, had she was the spa manager at the 5-star hotel, the Serena Hotel. She was one semester away from getting her master's degree at the International Islamic University. She was the only non-Muslim American to have ever enrolled at the university. She, you know, the classes were in English, but they were sort of half English, half Urdu. And she had also just been commissioned to start hosting a reality TV show in Urdu in which she was making over Pakistani women. So she was by no means ready to go anywhere. In fact, she had an Arabic test the next morning, and she said, "I'm not leaving." And I said, I don't think you really get it, what's going on down. You know, I kind of ran upstairs, and I said, "Listen, this is the deal." And she said, "Well, I've got this exam tomorrow. I'm not leaving." I said, no, you don't understand the severity of the situation." So she, one of her very overweight nutrition clients happened to be a cousin of the prime minister at the time. And so we called him. And I explained the situation, and he said, "Okay, take a deep breath, don't worry about it. I'm right now playing bridge with Musharraf's national security advisor, Tariq Aziz." He says, "So why don't you pass the phone to the senior-most police officer, and I'll pass the phone to Tariq Aziz, and everything will be fine." And I thought, all right, I've got a little bit of, you know, now I'm feeling a little bit better. And so I hand the phone to this poor police officer, and it was just, I mean, this guy, when I tell him he was on the other line, you could just see his face. He just thought, "Oh, how come I had to be the one to respond to this call tonight?" You know, and he gets browbeaten for 5 minutes for disturbing these Americans on this cold, rainy night, etc. And you know, and of course, the cop doesn't really know the details. He's just executing the deportation order. And Tariq Aziz doesn't really know the details, but he just knows that there's a friend of a friend who doesn't want to get kicked out of the country right now. So. This ultimately didn't, knowing anyone wouldn't have saved us. I mean, this is Musharraf's boyhood friend and right-hand man, and his influence couldn't save us. The apparatus, intelligence apparatus, had set in motion against us for whatever reason, whether it was for my traveling in SWAT, whether it was for what I wrote about SWAT. I mean, there was nothing implicitly critical. There was just the suggestion and the scene that the Taliban had taken over so close to Islamabad. So that 2 days later, my wife and I packed everything up, sold our car, gave away our cat, and we left Pakistan in early January. She has unfortunately not been able to go back, hasn't been able to finish the TV show, wasn't able to get her degree, wasn't able to take advantage of the opportunity to be the spa director, etc. She had a trip, you know, they had just, at the spa, they had just made plans to send her to Thailand for a month to live at a 5-star spa where she was going to learn the ways of running a spa. She was really not happy with me at all. But about 8 months after this incident, there had been a change in government, and I went back to the new government and asked if I could go back. I was going to go back and do a story for Smithsonian Magazine, sort of a milquetoast story about Sufism and about, you know, a very benign story by the things that the Pakistani government worries about reporters going and writing about. It wasn't anywhere near, you know, Taliban camps. But the notion was that, look, the Taliban make a lot of noise, and they have all the guns, but if you really want to understand what mainstream Islam is all about in Pakistan, it's the Sufi festivals, the Urs, the annual gatherings, that are really the truest indicator of what the mainstream in Pakistan, the kind of Islam that they embrace. And this festival was incredible. There were about 400,000 people that had all gathered, dancing, singing, you know, lots of hashish smoking. But if, like, I mean, it was really, you know, everyone kind of says that any gathering more than 100 people is like the Woodstock of this or the Woodstock of that. I mean, it really was just an incredible carnival-like environment. But in the middle of this reporting this story, I had been in the country about 10 days. I started getting phone calls from an anonymous caller, but from a phone number that I could recognize, from an individual saying, pretending to be people that didn't exist. First of all, pretending to be an intelligence official that didn't exist, and then pretending to be a newspaper editor that didn't exist, calling me and calling my fixer, requesting to meet me in Karachi. You know, my fixer said, something's not right about these calls. First of all, they're coming from a cell phone number, and if it was a government official that was calling, they would always conduct official business using a landline. So, I mean, this is, again, you talk about the kind of gut instincts that only a fixer has. I would have never known that, you know, small distinction. But so the fixer then calls the Interior Ministry and says, this guy named Ahmed Ali just called and said he works in this and that office in Karachi, and he's trying to meet my friend, he's requesting a meeting, and he said it's official. And the Interior Ministry says, neither does that person nor does that office exist. So we thought, all right, well, that's a little strange, right? It actually is very similar to the playbook, in fact, that kind of led up to Daniel Pearl's abduction, with people wanting to meet him in Karachi, pretending to be people that didn't exist, etc. And so this was like at 10 o'clock or 11 o'clock in the morning. By noon, local TV stations had started reporting that I had been kidnapped in Karachi. And so I had friends calling me and saying, are you okay? Because, you know, this TV station, that TV station says you've been kidnapped. And we thought, all right, something is really, really odd. It's one thing to be served a deportation order. It's another thing to have reports of your own demise showing up in the press. And so it was really difficult to discern whether why the intelligence agencies would be targeting me, and second of all, whether they were forecasting intent or whether this was just them trying to sort of get into my head. Ultimately, the U.S. Embassy got involved, and even after, I had to call them to ask them if they could help, but they said, you know, we're really glad you called because we've been picking up all these internal communications and we know that the intelligence agencies are watching you. I'm like, well, why didn't you call me yesterday and tell me this? Why? How come I had to call to ask about it? So they eventually put together a armored car to take me to the airport. It was a really, I mean, as a freelance journalist, you know, getting back to the beginning of this talk, you know, you go somewhere as a freelance journalist, you have no infrastructure supporting you, you take great risks, but you have to take risks to be able to sort of get some recognition. When, as a freelance journalist, you're being taken away in a bulletproof car is when you kind of realize that, all right, the game's up for me at this country. Like, I can no longer work here in the way that I want to if these are the conditions. So the embassy had someone who sort of walked me through customs and walked me through immigration to make sure that I got out fine. And then as I was sitting there trying to call my dad to tell him what had just gone down and that I was getting on a flight a week early and I was coming back, and my father, he was in the Pentagon at the time, and every time that I started trying to tell him the details of what had happened, the phone kept cutting off three times in a row. And I, at this point, you know, I'm just pulling my hair out. And when they finally said the flight's ready to board, I think that I must have been the first person in the back of the plane, locked in the bathroom, just get me to Dubai, please. So that was, you know, the unfortunate culmination of these 2 years in Pakistan. But you know, we can talk now, kind of bring it up to speed, and if anyone has questions, we'll go from there. So, thank you.
Wonder whether you had met or knew of Rory Stewart.
I don't. We.
I just because I'm reading his book by him. So.
Yeah, no, a lot of mutual friends, but I've never had the opportunity to meet him. Sure.
So, tell us a little more about the Taliban. You know, I think we have these images of the Taliban, and obviously you found some of them to be really friendly and engaging, and you know, I wonder, I mean, I've read a lot of literature that has characterized, like the Kite Runner and other, that have characterized the Taliban as almost like these homoerotic types, and, you know, tell us more about the character and the treatment of women and what you saw among the Taliban.
We could talk for another couple of hours. I'll try and give it a little bit of a boil down. I think that the Taliban first existed in Afghanistan as the government there from 1996 to 2001, and so that's kind of, and the remnants of that organization, the leadership of that organization took up residence in Quetta, a city in Pakistan's Balochistan, and increasingly throughout the country. But then you had about 3 or 4 years ago the emergence of the Pakistani Taliban, and in my mind the two are very, very different beasts. The Afghan Taliban being a general reflection of the conditions in the country, very, very poor, just kind of bumpkins that are fighting for, in my mind, fighting for a little bit more nationalistic reasons, in this case, right now, to drive the Americans out. I think that the Pakistani Taliban's ambitions are more transnational, more global. I think the Pakistani Taliban are more educated. They're coming from the cities. Pakistanis are generally speaking, much more educated than Afghans. There were a number of students from secular universities. I mean, it wasn't, just to get back a second, the Afghan Taliban were a result largely of religious schools, of madrasas. The Pakistani Taliban and those amongst their ranks are oftentimes a result or a product of secular schools. I mean, med students that suddenly, you know, have just sort of seen one thing too much. So I think that the level of radicalization, in my mind, of the Pakistani Taliban is much more significant, in that they also are in much closer contact with the foreign ideas that have been brought by Al-Qaeda, the ideas of this notion of takfirism, which is kind of excommunication, which is a very, very alien concept within mainstream Islam, but has been embraced increasingly by Al-Qaeda and by Pakistani Taliban. The treatment of women, the homoerotic, it's Ghazi once said something to me. He said, look, you know, I think that women are part of this movement. I mean, they had this, you know, remember the Ghazis next door to the Red Mosque, they had this female madrasa, and they were the ones, I mean, he called them my female commandos. They were in all black, and they were the ones that were actually, you know, taking the female brothel owners out of brothels. They, and Ghazi once said to me that it was kind of a twist on a well-known truism, but, you know, you teach one woman, you know, teach a man, and you teach a single person, you teach a woman about, you know, our ideas, and you teach a whole family. And so Ghazi was much, but I think that he also represented a little more of the progressive side of things. He was very, you know, he used to say that we don't want to go back to the 7th century. I want my CD, my walkie-talkie, my cell phone, my computer. I want to be plugged in. I just want to fuse these things. You know, the homoeroticism is there. There's no doubt about it. I mean, in areas of Pakistan, there are a number of towns along the border where that everyone has the same joke, and the joke is that the pigeons fly over this town, that town. I've heard it for Kandahar, I've heard it for Helmand, I've heard it for Banu, that the pigeons fly over this town with one wing because the other wing is covering their rear. Keeping women wearing burqas, women not going out in public, is not so much a Taliban idea as it is a traditional idea amongst Pashtuns that are living up and down this border area. I mean, in Banu, they used to say, look, you know, women have been wearing burqas for hundreds of years before the Taliban showed up. If the Taliban leave tomorrow, the women are still going to be wearing burqas. This is just something that sort of is indigenous to the culture. So I think that is something that is often overlooked, is the extent to which gender relations are a Taliban idea or a religious idea, or whether they're a reflection of the local culture.
Sure.
So, sort of going along those same lines, you said that you said all the forces that fostered the Taliban, and then you talked about the quote, the youth are ready to fight. Mm-hmm. So, what were the youth ready to fight for? What did they think they were fighting for? And talk a little more about these forces that were fostering the Taliban.
Right. Well, I mean, so when I say forces in the 90s, you know, the Pakistani economic even and military and intelligence establishment needed a way to be able to bring Pakistani goods across Afghanistan into Central Asia, and then Central Asian goods into South Asia. It was profitable for them to have stability, which they did not have in 1992, 1993, 1994, 1995. So bringing the Taliban to power, making sure that they had support, making sure that they were well-armed, it aligned with the ideas of the Pakistani religious establishment, of these religious parties that talk about constitutional democracy, and in some cases may believe in constitutional democracy, using constitutional democracy to achieve their ultimate means, which are living in an Islamic state. So that, I think, are the forces that fostered them. As to what they're fighting against, it increasingly becomes something that's almost, it's so emotional, and it's so, the drone strikes were incredibly radicalizing while I was there. The drone strikes, from reports and friends there, have become a little bit less radicalizing, because now the drones have become significantly more precise. The drones that are fired, you know, these drones that are fired from CIA Reapers and Predators in the tribal areas, they've become more precise for a couple reasons. Because the Taliban, there is a distinction that should be made between the idea of the Taliban and the abstract idea of the Taliban and the Taliban as a reality. And up until very recently, I think Pakistanis in major cities there was always an appeal of the Taliban as an abstraction. This gets back to the question of what they're fighting for. The Taliban represented those who were willing to fight against the Americans. They represented those who were trying to live according to the pure form of Islamic law. And as an abstract idea, there's not really anything that you could argue if you were an urban Pakistani about those things. Frankly, you're a Muslim. Frankly, you don't like the idea that there are American soldiers in your neighboring country and even operating in Pakistan. So the idea of the Taliban is very appealing, but no one really wanted the Taliban, the guys with the beards and the guns and the turbans, to be standing on their street corners. And that distinction held up fairly well for several years, and the Taliban were able to play on that and were able to get public support because of support for the idea of them. Last spring, when the Taliban moved out of Swat, they were essentially given Swat as a mini-state, and the deal worked for like 2 weeks. And then they moved out of Swat and they moved into a neighboring district, and this put them within 60 miles of Islamabad. And suddenly that distinction collapsed. The drone strikes, in my mind, are becoming more precise because more people are willing to speak again, to drop a dime on the guy who's going to be meeting tomorrow in that house. I mean, these missiles can't land in these very small, cloistered, xenophobic villages without someone on the inside giving information as to where these guys are meeting. Now, I say xenophobic in the sense that people, they know who's coming in and who's coming out. If you've got an invitation, you know, you're probably going to be welcome, but again, someone just doesn't waltz into a village in North Waziristan and all of a sudden, you know, get on his walkie-talkie and start calling in American airstrikes. So, I don't know if that answers your question a little bit, but, yeah. Sure.
My feeling is, what Peter Galbraith in Afghanistan, anyway, feels like the military is not going to solve anything. What's your opinion of that?
Well, I mean, I think that, you know, when you look at the sort of statements that President Karzai has been making in the past week, it begs a lot of questions. I mean, it's something that's very, obviously very close to me, because my brother could deploy to Afghanistan any day, and, you know, there's... It's hard. The military can only achieve so much if there's no political will from the local leadership to be in cahoots. I mean, I think there are a couple sides to the story. I think the President Karzai has a base. I think that his base is becoming deeply cynical towards the Americans, and so President Karzai is thinking about his own political survival. And he's thinking that if he continues sort of to be seen as an American puppet, that he's toast come the next election. Even if he's going to have to, I think, finagle the Constitution some way. But so that it's probably true. There's no military solution to this at all. But it is part of the solution. And I think that for the militants in Pakistan, for the hardcore Al Qaeda leaders, it's the only solution. But when you're fighting something where you have people that are on the fence in Afghanistan and people that are fighting for the perception of fighting for their homes and for their country, there's a lot more involved than just, you know, than just beating them down. Sure.
Greg Mortensen, did you meet him, or did you see the influence that he made in the areas that you're speaking of?
You know, he No, I've never met him. It's a great question. And if I think that if I was smart before I started talking about my book, I would have at least found a way to call him and talk to him for 2 minutes so that I could have said yes to that question every time I asked that. But he, you know, he, the areas where he's building the school, from what I understand, are areas that are conservative, are areas that are very traditional, are areas that are in the mountains, but are not necessarily areas. I mean, he isn't going into North Waziristan, where Al Qaeda and the hardest core Taliban are, and sort of saying, "Excuse me, I'm coming in to build a school." So that is so I didn't see any of the influence myself, and even when we traveled up to the northern areas, I didn't. But I also wasn't specifically looking for it. Sure.
I hear India is sticking their nose in Afghanistan to get the Pakistani people really upset.
It's drawing room chatter in Pakistan that the Indians are everywhere. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the Indians are, there are four Indian consulates in Afghanistan. Mazar-e-Sharif, Herat, Jalalabad, Kandahar, and then there's one embassy in Kabul. If you ask the number of Pakistanis, they'll tell you that there are thousands of Indian consulates all up and down the border. You know, the Indians have been, there is an extent, to some extent, that the Indians and the Pakistanis are fighting for influence in Afghanistan. And the Indians, I think, have been smart about trying to project soft power, if you will. I subscribe as much nefarious intents to what India is doing in Afghanistan as to what Pakistan is doing in India and what India is doing in Pakistan. I mean, I think that you just have to expect a certain amount. I think it's kind of almost, I don't know if anyone's seen this movie, The Ghost Rider, that's playing now. I mean, I feel like the veil of lifting, I feel like the perception that there's, that an intelligence agency for any country is doing something negative in another country, I feel like the shock of that is sort of worn off in recent years. And so now, I mean, I'm sure the Indians are doing something in Pakistan, and I'm sure the Pakistanis are doing something in India and Afghanistan. So, sure.
Do you have any sense of how they reconcile the strong anti-Western, anti-modern rhetoric with their enthusiastic embrace of modern and Western technology?
I mean, I think the argument that you often hear is a legal one, and that is that traditional Pakistanis who are espousing an embrace of strict Islamic or of Islamic law. I mean, people always talk about strict Islamic law and strict Sharia. I mean, I think that you know, it is what it is, whether it's strict or not strict. So, but I think that those people who are espousing those ideas, they're doing it on a legal basis, because what they're saying is that, look, you know, we are a Muslim-majority country and we're still being governed according to, you know, they used to say all the time that we're being governed according to British law, we're being dictated to by the Americans. And so I think that it's a nationalistic perception, and it's also a legal one. And I think that that's kind of how they reconcile. I don't know if that's a satisfactory answer, but let me think about it as we're going. I'll see if I come up with anything better. Sure.
I recall having heard Javed Chowdhury say that part of the problem in this area is that it's occupied by infidels. And I remember, I hope I'm correct, Javed, that you said that it would be easier to deal with this if we brought in Muslims to fight. For example, from Turkey, we'd have Muslims, and it would cost a lot less money. Are you here, Javed?
Yes. Right, absolutely.
One of you comment, please.
Well, I mean, I think that it's a great point, for sure. And it gets back to this question that I was just mentioning about the law aspect. I mean, there's that argument will forever be available so long as these Muslim states are not being ruled according to Muslim law, so long as there are non-Muslims occupying Muslim lands. So that certainly is a valid argument. I don't know that Turkey is, it's also would be a deeply unpopular move by the Turks to send, you know, 10,000 troops to Afghanistan to go fight against other Muslims.
Oh, yeah.
So while a good idea, well, certainly a good idea in the abstract, I don't know that it's a feasible idea in a practical sense.
I'm hoping to hear from Java.
Java, do you have a response?
Well, actually, what I said was to replace NATO American troops with troops from Turkey and Bangladesh under the auspices of the United Nations to bring about this peace and reconstruction. We are there as invaders, and so are the native troops. So to bring about the reconstruction of Afghanistan is going to be very difficult as long as you're fighting and trying to bring it about. The Turks and the Bengalis would go in as peacemakers and reconstruct the country. Turks want to fight.
And I think that's a great point, but, and not to sound overly cynical, but UN peacekeepers, if we could name an example of when UN peacekeepers have successfully gone and kept the peace and allowed a country to rebuild, I mean, we think about what's happening in Eastern Congo right now, UN peacekeepers have been there and it will probably be there for decades, only making the situation worse in many cases. So, again, it's just, I don't think that it's not the fault of the Bengalis or the Pakistani peacekeepers or the Turks or any of the peacekeepers themselves. It's just, I think, the overall superstructure. That's that the mandateless role that they've been there. I mean, I was in Bosnia in February and was at Srebrenica and was talking to people about the role or utter lack thereof that the Dutch peacekeepers had in Srebrenica. And I mean, it's amazing when you think about what UN peacekeepers are ostensibly there to do and the tools that they're not given to actually be able to do the job. Yeah. So, was there a hand in the back?
Could you, and would you be interested in writing an article that emphasize or look for common ground among the various players that you've been mentioning, and that common ground could serve as some way of thinking about the situation that might lead to an improvement?
I would hope that someone is thinking of doing that. I think it's a debate that all journalists have, I don't think of my role as being one to necessarily offer solutions. I think of my role as being, I'm willing to go, I'm willing to see, I'm willing to describe, I'm willing to try and empathetically paint the story in as objective a way as possible. I think that the role of coming up with solutions is for those who are sort of policy wonks in D.C. or those who are politicians. So, like you said, I mean, I would hope that there's someone working on it. And if someone asks, I would, be happy to give my advice, but it's a little bit beyond my realm.
What I tried to say.
Sure.
I was not suggesting an article that proposed or gave solutions, but only qualities that the different players have in common, like hospitality that you offered
right.
to the Taliban.
Right.
Like other basic qualities that people share. They're not solutions, but just places where they can connect with each other. Mm. Solutions may come from other people
right.
to identify these fundamentals, what I'm talking about.
Okay, I'll keep it in mind. Thanks. Sure, ma'am.
Afghanistan has a lot of tribes and tribal leaders. Does Pakistan have the same, and is that a better way to connect with these people than trying to impose a democracy that they're not used to?
They do. They do in Pakistan. I mean, particularly, there are tribes all over Pakistan. The tribes have been traditionally very strong in the areas where the Taliban are now strong. The Taliban, though, is as a military strategy, and their Al-Qaeda allies, as a military strategy, they almost preempted. It was almost as if they started doing this in 2003, 2004, 2005, before the Anbar awakening and the surge took place in Iraq, but it's almost as if they saw it coming and they didn't want to let it happen in the Pakistani tribal areas. And what happened is that they began assassinating hundreds of tribal leaders up and down the Pakistani-Afghanistan, up along the Pakistan-Afghanistan border, so that now there is no tribal authority. There's a vacuum, and the Taliban has stepped in to assume that role. I mean, there was the name Betullah Masood, if that rings any bells, he was the head of the Pakistani Taliban up until the time that he was killed in August. And he was often referred to as a chieftain of the Massoud tribe in South Waziristan, which was a totally erroneous notion. I have a friend who is from the Massoud tribe and whose uncle is a sort of, you know, they don't, there's also, there's sort of as a, they rule, there are tribal chiefs, there are in many cases not one tribal chief as much as, particularly in the tribal areas themselves, but they kind of rule by committee. But, you know, his uncle was still there in South Waziristan, but had watched as Betula and Betula's allies had knocked off all of the main tribal leaders so that they then just sort of stepped into that role. And no one, Betula and his people had more guns than anyone else, and so none of the other tribal leaders dared defy him. And then thus he became, by default, the tribal chieftain. And so the tribes do exist, but they've been thoroughly corrupted over the course of the past 5 years. In the back, sir?
As a terrorist tactician moving chess pieces around on a board, what's your opinion of Bin Laden's success or failure in terms of what's taken place with the U.S. invading Iraq, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and who knows what's next, Iran?
I think that I think that Bin Laden's biggest success is that he's still alive, because as the nominal leader of Al Qaeda, I think that his role, his operational role, is extremely, extremely limited. If we look at the case of North Africa and the Al-Qaeda chapter that's blossomed there in recent years, they are called Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb, or Al-Qaeda in North Africa. They are a franchise of Al-Qaeda. They've gotten the blessing of Ayman al-Zawahiri, but there's absolutely no institutional relationship between the two. So the fact that Bin Laden, though, is still alive, like you said, means that there are still Americans looking for him. And as Javed said, that means that there are still American troops in Muslim lands further radicalizing people that yesterday were not radicalized. So that is a phenomenon that has certainly played to Bin Laden's benefit. And I think that, you know, in terms of the question of him still being alive, I think that even though we see the noose tightening around the Pakistani Taliban and even around the Haqqani network, which is based in North Waziristan, I mean, the Pakistanis and the American establishment or intelligence establishment admit to the papers on a daily basis that they have no idea where Bin Laden is. And the problem is, so long as Bin Laden is alive, Obama has absolutely no strategic choice of leaving Afghanistan. He cannot leave Afghanistan so long as Bin Laden's there. If Bin Laden's killed in a drone tomorrow, you realize the range of policy choices that open up for him overnight. I mean, now all of a sudden he can go to the American public and say, I've done what I said I was going to do. Screw Hamid Karzai. You know, we're taking our soldiers. We're leaving. We've killed Bin Laden. But as long as he's still there, I mean, I think that for every day that Bin Laden remains alive, that is a small strategic victory for him. Is there another question in the back? Yes, sir.
Yes. What is the size of the Taliban and who's providing the logistical and financial support?
Great question.
The question was what the size of the Taliban and who's providing the logistical and financial support. I think that the numbers vary. I mean, I don't think that there's any real hard number. I think that if you were to look in Afghanistan as the people who are fighting against the Americans, it has to be in the high tens of thousands, I would think. But that's a guess. And not all of them are sort of subsumed under the Taliban's leadership structure. Many of them are you know, you've got freelancers, you've got people that are fighting with Gulbuddin Hekmatyar's group up in northeastern Afghanistan. And in Pakistan, I think it's a very similar situation where you have this range of jihadi organizations that have emerged in the past two decades, some to fight against the Indians in Kashmir, some to fight against Shias in Pakistan, that are all sort of working with the Taliban, but not necessarily, again, you know, they refer to themselves as members of Jaish-e-Mohammed, or Sepah Sahaba, or one of these other jihadi organizations, rather than as a member of the Taliban. So that becomes difficult to put a number. I would guess, though, I don't know, how many militants are in the tribal areas, a rough guess, 10,000, 5,000 maybe? Hard to say. The question of logistical and financial support, I don't know about logistics. Finances, again, I don't know, but there are two primary suspected ways. One of them is the poppy proceeds. Which, of course, you know, Hamid Karzai's brother is you know, elbow deep in. The other is actually support from rich, wealthy individuals in the Gulf. Not necessarily the Saudi government, but I mean, look, when an articulate member of the Taliban comes to the UAE, United Arab Emirates, and goes to Dubai and meets one of these wealthy sheikhs and says, "There's a happy hour. You're a Muslim sheikh. There is a happy hour taking place where there are all these infidels drinking beer right now. If nothing else, you know, give us a couple $1 million for as we're trying to, you know, purge the infidels out of Afghanistan." That resonates. And so I think that there's a lot of money that is being unaccounted for that's also coming through those sorts of channels.
Sure. This all started because of us in Saudi Arabia offending bin Laden, and then him focusing after he came back from Afghanistan on the U.S. and kicking the infidels out of Saudi Arabia.
Well, I mean, you know, it's hard to know, you know, where it starts. There have been so many great books about blowback that have been written. I mean, the fantastic book, All the Shah's Men, about the 1953 coup that overturned, the CIA overturned Mohammad Mossadegh, you know, Iran. So if you look at sort of anti-Americanism in Iran, you've got that. So, you know, certainly the relationship with the Saudis is a thoroughly troubled and complex one, to put it lightly. But, you know, it is what it is. I think you've hit the nail on the head. It's just, what do you do about it now? Go ahead. Do you have a question?
Yeah, just to broaden it out away from the extremist and more into the mainstream society, what do you see as the most moderating influences on the society that move people more toward moderation away from radical behaviors? And what are the institutions, either domestic or international institutions, that are working on the ground that should be supported to create more moderating impact?
Well, I think that the international institutions, any international institutions, even if the intentions are good, are still going to have mixed results, just because, frankly, they're not local, and so they're non-Muslims trying to tell Muslims how to live or how to provide for their children or how to teach their children, etc. We wonder why all these young Pakistanis and young Afghans are going to madrasas or Islamic seminaries. You know, the main reason is because the public school system is broken. So one of the most troubling things I find is that the moderate element, those with Ivy League educations, are actually right now in many cases running English language newspapers that are at the tip of the spear in hawking conspiracies about CIA plots to overthrow the Pakistani government and take their nuclear weapons. And that actually is thoroughly, thoroughly troubling, because now these are the people who you would think, I mean, there was a woman who I kind of worked for the 2 years that I was there, who now runs a newspaper. She speaks perfect English. She's got a PhD from Columbia. And she, on her front page of her newspaper, publishes pictures of individuals that her newspaper claims are CIA agents that are like, you know, AP reporters and you know, photographers for Reuters sort of thing. So this is, I mean, this kind of conspiracy mongering is deeply troubling. And the problem is that if that level of society is buying it, then why would someone who has a fourth grade education not buy it? So on that, sorry, thoroughly depressing note, thank you all so much for coming out. It's been great. And